Elise Wells.
And we just want to thank you for coming back. We have an exciting show for you today. We have an actor, a good friend of mine, and he's been in tons of television films. He's here to promote a new movie here in Oregon called Alien Abduction. You got to go see it. It's awesome. It looks intense. And so we'll get into that here in a few minutes. But Peter's done a lot of, he has done other paranormal films. He's done one called Under the Bed, and I believe that was from 2012. And then this Alien Abduction, which is premiering in Portland, Oregon at the Clinton Street Theater at 10 o'clock tomorrow night, Friday, May 2nd. And so I look forward to, well, we look forward
yeah,
to.
Yeah, I will be there.
Yeah, you better
I'll be there. I am.
It's going to be awesome.
I'll be there or be square, right?
That's right. So, well, have you been over the last week?
I've been good. Yeah? I've been really good. I actually went to a gluten-free diet.
Good.
And I know there's people that are intolerant or they just have sensitivities to it. And then, of course, you go really extreme. But, you know, I don't know whether intolerant or not, but it has been amazing. I've been feeling so much better.
Feeling better then?
Yeah. Good. Just lighter.
Okay. But the question of the week is, where's the Boo doll? Oh my gosh, here we go again.
All right.
Okay.
Next time.
I said bring the Boo doll next time and you didn't do it. So that's all right.
Well, I have to find where Emily hid it.
Okay. Well, Emily's out there somewhere, so she can probably hear us.
Yeah.
Maybe she can just run home.
Yeah, run home, get Boo.
Just run across the bridge, you know.
She can sing her little songs.
We can do it next time.
Okay.
Yeah. So now, see, we're going to build up so much excitement about this Boo doll that you're going to have to just...
Everyone's going to have to go get one.
Well, everybody's going to have to go get one.
I know. There's nothing like a good monster.
So it'll be Boo 1, Boo 2, Boo 3, Boo 3.
Boo-hoo.
Yeah, boo-hoo, you know. Why not? So, well, I'm excited.
Yes.
Paranormal Crossings, we're going through so many changes right now, and we were hoping to get on Blog Talk, but it doesn't look like it's working at the moment. So if you see me kind of look away, it's because I'm trying to get it up and running. But we do have our special guest, Peter. And so let's go ahead and introduce him. Peter Holden, welcome to the show. Thank you so much.
Howdy, howdy.
How are you?
I'm doing well, sir. How are you?
I'm doing excellent. Thank you.
Good, good.
I can't thank you enough for being here and
thank you for
having
me.
Our show. Yes.
Yeah. Thanks for the promotion, letting people know about the movie. I appreciate it.
Well, good. Well, I know I'm excited about it, and Elise and my whole family, everyone's excited about
cool.
it. So
cool.
Our hope is to get the entire Portland metro area excited about this movie.
That would be very cool.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So
we would like that. It's a really, really fun little project.
So what have you been doing? I mean, you've got this movie, you've got Under the Bed. So talk to us about a little bit about your history with being an actor and when you went out to LA. And
well, yeah, I'm from here. I'm from Gresham, went to Gresham High, graduated '89. So I've just outed my age.
Everybody's awesome. Calculating right now.
Exactly. It's 42, almost 43, in case you're wondering.
Great. Well, see, we went to high school together, so everybody's going to know both of our ages.
Right? Right. Well, and you've been telling people you're 22 for so long.
Exactly.
You know,
well, I am.
Yeah.
At heart.
Exactly. I actually, that's funny, because I really do believe 40 is the new 20.
Well, yeah.
I do. And I know that because
unless you have to go through the colonoscopy,
that's just preparation.
It's been a whole list of stuff. I mean,
no, because
I'm checked out. It's like running into what, you know, you go get your cars inspected, you know.
Right.
You know, go
exactly.
in. Inspect me.
What I know, though, is that I am far better at being 20 now than I was when I was 20.
Yeah.
So awesome. Obviously, I'm 20 again.
Right.
When did you start acting?
I was young. My dad was actor and director here in Portland, and
he saw it in you.
Well, I did my first show for him back in 1979.
Wow!
Was he a hard coach? Was he, you know, a little bit hard on you than he was most of the people that would have?
No, I mean he was inspirational. I think he was harder. I mean he was, you know, compliments were harder to get until time went on. But
right.
as far as he was, just always very supportive and. And a lot of people in the theater community in town at that time I knew and were, you know, very much a part of my kind of upbringing. So
now, were you a Peter Pan kind of theater person, or were you more of a, you know, a little bit on the...
Or more David Mamet. Was I doing Peter Pan or David Mamet?
Right.
Yeah. Probably more Mamet. Yeah. I would say Mamet-esque. Yeah.
I can tell in some of the clips that we saw with these movies coming up, you do play a very masculine, fatherly role.
I've been playing fathers a lot. Yeah, that's one of the things about turning 40 is suddenly, you know, you're not getting the romantic lead perhaps as much, more dads.
Right.
And the kids that I'm playing are getting older.
Yeah.
like an under the bed, you know, even though they're supposed to be 16 and 12 respectively, they're actually, I think they were 23 and 14 or 15.
If only we could all age like that.
Yeah.
I mean, really, you know, that would be wonderful.
That would be so cool to have that knowledge. But yeah, I've been playing a lot of dads recently but I moved down there in 90. I skipped town in 1990 and been down there ever since.
Was it easy for you? I mean, I know a lot of people talk about going to California and they just want to, you know, they want to get out there. They just, you know, I'm going to go to California. I'm going to become a movie star. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, what can you say about L.A.? Is there a different route? I know you mentor a lot of children in kind of the acting.
Mentor professionals. I mean, I teach.
Children.
I teach. Yeah, but not kids. Actually, I'm not particularly great with kids as a teacher.
But what's the age, right?
Yeah. Several 50-year-olds who are not nearly as mature as a lot of my own 16-year-old. You know, L.A. is a tough town. It took me 7 years to like L.A. Mm. You know, it took me kind of seven years.
Oh, so you actually like it?
I do, actually. Oh, I do. Wow. I mean, there's fantasy parts of me that wants to move home and come back up here, assuming a couple things can work right. But, I do like L.A. You know, there's a tremendous amount of history there. And when you get out of the Hollywood parts of L.A., the Hollywood sides of L.A., it's a historical Mexican town.
Well, as much filming as they've been doing in Canada, I mean, you're closer to Canada being here than you really are.
Yeah, but those Canadians like Canadians working. Yeah.
Really?
They're kind of very into that, yes.
Really?
Yeah, if you're an American production going up there, most of your crew, a good chunk of your actors are going to be Canadian by requirement.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I don't know if you remember this, but as I said, Pete and I go way back. I went to L.A., stayed with him for a week, and he almost killed me in Beverly Hills off of Chevy Chase Drive.
I'm blanking.
Yeah, I know, and I'm throwing you on the spot now. But the yellow Volvo, driving me around in this 1910 yellow Volvo.
1971, but close.
Okay, 71.
It's a 71 Volvo, yeah.
And you're pointing out all these places we're on Chevy Chase Drive. You're not paying attention, and I'm not paying attention, and we're just paying attention to what's around us. And you go into an intersection, and all of a sudden we hear a car screeching and horns honking.
Oh, that's right.
Next thing I know, kissing the windshield. And
the tour is over.
Oh, my gosh. It was awesome.
I do remember that. That's right. I don't remember ever being as scared as right at that moment, so shocked by the amount of cars in front of me.
Exactly.
I remember that, yeah.
Oh, it was scary.
And I'm sure
being on Chevy Chase
and I'm sure we were totally sober. I'm sure it was complete sobriety going on.
Totally sober. Oh,
yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Well, it was the 90s. We were all sober in the 90s.
Now, let's not even bring up the 80s. So
we were just warming up in the 80s.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So does it make it a difference that you are a father? Does that help you in any way in your roles?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think the birth of my kids made me a much, much better artist.
Awesome.
You know, in fact, it was funny, the couple of years just before my daughter was born, my oldest was born, I'd kind of gone away from acting. I was a marketing director at the Pasadena Playhouse. I was going more into marketing and business sides of it. And, you know, I was still working, but I was only working once or twice a year. It wasn't enough to make a living. And you know, most people when they have children get really rational. They go, you know what? I'm gonna get a straight job. I'm gonna get a normal job because I have children now and I'm responsible.
Right.
And I went the exact opposite. I decided to go, you know what? I have to go back to acting.
There you go.
That makes a lot more sense to me
now
that I have children.
Yeah.
And part of it helped that at that time, job I was in was kind of ending. But so I go back to acting at that point. I went back at full time, and I found I was a much better artist than I was after their birth.
And plenty of apologies to mom and dad on the phone saying, I'm so sorry for the things that I did when I was younger because I had no idea.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And please tell me how to get this child to calm down.
Yeah, well, it's funny, yeah, because I think my mother she's still not very happy karmically that I've gotten as good at children as I've gotten.
Oh.
She really wanted some more payback,
I think. They do believe that. They're like, you know, when
you're going to get it.
Yeah, when you
you're going to get it. And then the funny thing is, I didn't get it. At least, you know, not... Knock wood, not yet. I mean, they're really extraordinary.
It'll
kids.
Happen when you're awesome. When you're set to babysit in future your grandchildren.
My grandchildren, it'll skip a generation.
There you go.
Right. Yeah. Well, and you'll be going, what the hell happened here?
Yeah, you but I'll be the grandpa going, no, I totally get this, dude. Chill out.
Right. Just go eat the rest of the bowl of candy. Your mom will be here in an hour.
You're my mom's fine. Biggest thing was always, and you know my mom, mm-hmm. I hope you have children just like you.
Yeah.
That's and good. You know what? I don't.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
I know, she's like, damn.
You know, now, there are times where I'll call her up and say, oh, and she goes, I told you.
That's right. Yeah.
Great. Thanks.
Yeah, my mom will be like, my son went through a little something earlier this year, and my mom's like, mm-hmm.
Yeah, I love the little silent, mm-hmm.
Yeah, she didn't give any comments. She didn't have, you know, my mom. I mean, she just had this little quiet little Norwegian. Oh, really?
Oh, exactly.
Oh, yeah.
Do your children have any interest in becoming actor or actresses?
No.
Really?
I've pushed them very hard away from that. I wouldn't allow it. I've had friends, directors and stuff, who want them involved in things over the years, and I wouldn't allow it. Mm. Just too hard a business for a kid. And them acting and doing stuff in school and you know, from an artistic perspective, I love the art. But from a professional perspective, I think it's a soul-sucking, horrible business.
Yeah.
And you make choices, you know, I love a lot of what I do, but not for a kid.
It's always the funny question of, oh, they're an actor, they must be a millionaire. You know, first of all, if you're living in L.A., you know, chances are you're not because of the cost of living.
Well,
a sandwich down the street costs you $14.
And it's getting tough. I mean, it's actually, I think it's tougher to make a living now than it was when I first went to L.A. as an actor.
Yeah.
It's a lot tougher. I mean, there's a lot more opportunity, there's a lot more things being done, but they're also, you know, a lot cheaper. And you're not getting paid the same. It used to be four networks. You got a, you know, guest star. You knew what you were making. You knew you were kind of set for a few months' bills. And you just don't have that same kind of thing now for actors going into it. And I think, you know, being a young actor today, you got to be entrepreneurial. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're not actually getting out there and hanging out with people who are doing cool shit, then you're not gonna move forward.
You've obviously worked both sides of the table. So as the actor part, then production, producer stuff. Which one do you seem to be most, you like the most, enjoy the most?
Well, I mean, I fundamentally, I'm an actor. I mean, my perspective when I produce, my perspective when I direct is still coming from, that's my art. That's the thing I best understand. Mm-hmm. And so my perspective in coming to those things is still coming out of as an actor, from an actor's perspective. I mean, I've been acting for 30 years. I've been producing for less than 10. So that's the bulk of my knowledge. But having said that, they're all kind of the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know, I kind of tell people, it's all the same shit.
Really?
You know, it's really just different sides of the same coin. I mean, it's the thing I love about producing particularly, is I love putting teams together. I like putting really talented people together with, hopefully a great script and with whatever budget level you're working on, try to actually
meet that.
Yeah. I mean, just to get it done. I mean, there's a little miracle in getting a film, any film done, no matter what the budget or what you're doing. It's miraculous. It works.
And to have that accomplishment on screen so people can go.
Producers know how to herd cats. You got to be able to herd cats.
Oh.
You got to get a lot of different artistic minds working in the same direction. Mm. And those who can do it, producers who can do it in a way that doesn't cause drama are the good ones. Mm-hmm. You know, so far so good. I have, you know, while we've had drama in other legal parts of some of the things I produced that were beyond my control, the actual production of stuff has been pretty drama-free and done some cool stuff. And directing, I just started doing a year ago. I really like directing.
Right. Did you, in this new movie that's coming out, are you pretty much the actor in this movie? Or
in Alien Abduction? Mm-hmm. It's an ensemble cast. There's five of us. So I'm the father of this family that's going camping. And then we're abducted.
By aliens.
By aliens. Thus the name of the movie. It's the thing
I was kind of wondering about that.
No, yeah. What's this movie about?
Yeah.
Well, because there were other titles. There was like Brown Mountain Lights. There was Project Blue Book. There were these different titles that we'd gone through in the process. And then when, I guess it was Lawrence Bender's people said, you know, let's just call it Alien Abduction. I went, that's perfect.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
It tells us exactly what it is, you know?
Very cool.
I mean, we're not, to be honest, shooting for an Oscar on this film. It's a found footage alien picture.
Mm. Right. And you think we're at the time right now, people are ready for aliens. People are ready to absorb some alien thought.
Yeah.
I mean.
Yeah, I mean, I've been really interested, just the research in the film alone as far as the phenomenon behind the film. I mean, it's a fictionalized film, but the phenomenon of it is really interesting. You know, the Brown Mountain Lights were a real phenomenon going on in North Carolina for, first recorded of it like 1,200 years ago. And there are these lights that go out in the valleys, and they're spheres, and they do these weird right angles and stuff and go flying off in different spaces, and you can go see them. No one knows what they are. NASA can't figure it out. The Weather Department can't figure it out. They've been researching it for years. No one can figure out exactly or even vaguely what these lights are, and they've been observed. Well, along with these observations in this time of year when they're observed, there have been abduction stories that have been going on. There's abduction stories from, you know, 700 years ago of the Iroquois, or whatever they, I can't remember exactly what the tribe was, thought the gods were attacking, so they send off a few hundred, you know, warriors who all disappeared, never to be heard from again.
Wow.
Other story of in the mid-1800s, I think it was just before the Civil War, slave owner took a couple hundred slaves, went off to figure out what the lights were, and they all disappeared. They sent another search party out looking for them the next night while the lights were still there. They all disappeared, not completely without a trace.
Wow.
And
those, is it a timing thing? Does it happen at a certain time of year, or is it like every day?
They do. They tend to happen in fall, like late summer, fall,
so
up through about
November.
Yeah, when we were shooting there, it was when they were going on, is when the time of year they happened. And in fact, I had a kind of our first production meeting where they're explaining to us what the phenomenon is and how this is all kind of based. Director's giving us the cast, the pitch. I was like, okay, let me get this straight. So we're going to a place to shoot in a place of where people have been abducted. While that's happening,
are you going to ensure we're not going to be abducted here?
Well, that's what I said. I said, well, so what do you guys do? He's like, oh, don't worry about it. You guys have been really well insured. I'm like, oh, well, thank God.
That's
at least the movie will get done.
Right.
You know, we might get abducted, but the film.
You might be gone, but
my children, my wife, everybody will have a little bit. It'll be
the investors are cleared. We're good. Yeah, exactly.
Boy, could you imagine trying to claim that on an insurance claim?
Abduction?
My husband was abducted.
Oh, some of these waiver forms have all kinds of weird stuff when you're being insured for stuff. That there was one point at it, right near where we were shooting was some of the best zip line parks in the world. It's like 25 miles of zip lines. It looked amazing. The crew was like, they were going, and we're like, yeah, man, we want to go. The producer comes and goes, you guys don't get to. The insurance won't cover it. See, I'm like, what? Come on, man, it's right there.
Yeah, sign me up. Can I sign a waiver that says I'm just taking
I even said I'll stay a day later, after work, you know, so it's I'm not on that. And they're just like, no, you're insured up through, you know, until post is done. And
you're
going
to have to go back, I guess.
Come on. I totally want to. It looks amazing. A bunch of the crew did it. It looks fabulous to do.
Yeah.
That's a really beautiful part of the country.
Now, were you the kids that played your kids, were they aware of the history of the area that you were going to be in?
So what was their
reaction?
And they were very into it. I mean, Corey...
Was it cool, or was it like, oh my gosh?
It was cool. It was, freaky and fun. I think, of the cast anyway, I was probably the most... skeptical. Mm. I'm naturally kind of a skeptic in most ways. Mm. But I did have an experience with it that was interesting. But I mean, just to answer their question, they were totally into it.
Really?
You know, yeah, Corey, the kid who plays my son, my oldest son, he has had experience seeing ghosts. Mm. He was convinced his room was haunted, that he was staying in on this. We were staying in this, what do you call it, a chalet, kind of like a ski chalet thing. And he was convinced his room was haunted, and there was all kinds of haunting things that they were concerned about.
And what's his name?
That's Corey Ed.
Corey Ed. Should have had him call in. Could talk a little bit about
I know, Corey, if you're watching or you're watching this effect, call in.
That's right.
Give the number.
Yes, by the way, if you would like to call in and speak with our guest or Elise and myself, the number is 503-667-7555, and you should probably be able to see it on the screen as well. So feel free, call in. We have the phones that are open and ready, so.
Cool, yeah.
So tell us, okay, so you told us the other night at dinner that you have
We had an experience. We had an experience, yeah.
Well,
so one night we're shooting in some valley, some really, in the middle of the boondocks, nowhere valley. And late night shoot, so it's like 2 a.m, 3 a.m, whatever it was. And the woman
3 o'clock hour is the bewitching hour.
There you go.
No, that can make some sense.
Yeah.
So they go, so the daughter and my Jillian and Catherine, who plays my wife, they go taking a walk. And the boys, you know, we're just waiting for setups. We're like, well, let's go find them after they hadn't come back for a while. And so we go heading down this incredibly dark road and, you know, seeing how much our phone flashlights can, you know, light the way as we're going. And as we're walking along this, we kind of hit this curve and we see these lights like 30, 40 yards ahead of us, kind of like just off the road. And initially, my thought was like, oh, that's weird. I didn't think there was a farmhouse down here. I didn't know there was a farmhouse. And they're like, yeah, that is weird. And then all of a sudden, as we're walking closer to it, the lights just go down, up, boom, and then gone.
Really?
And they're in three in formation. They're just gone.
Were you guys recording at all with your phones?
No, we were not.
Oh, man.
obviously, in retrospect, that would have been cool.
Yeah,
we were.
Yeah.
It was more like, what's that?
A new movie.
Yeah, exactly. So they go out, and I'm like, well, that's just weird. I mean, I can't deny what I just saw. I can't deny I can't deny it. So we walk down a little farther, and we're kind of it's pitch black. We're trying to figure out what's out there, and then the girls come walking up from the other direction. And they're like, did you see that? There's a farmhouse in there. I guess their lights went out or electricity must have gone out. And so Catherine kind of saw the same thing I did as far as her relation to it. It had to be a farmhouse. But it was weird. The angle of it was just, I'm trying to figure out, well, did they have a blow? Did one of their lights blow down there or something like that? So we go up and go back to the base camp, and we're talking to the local guy. And we told him what happened. He's like, dude, there's no farm in 50 miles from here.
Wow.
There's no electricity down here. They have never ran lines down here. There's no way for the lines to be down there at all. Which I definitely...
What's your reading on it?
Well, you see what you believe.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, seeing is believing. You said that, I think it was you were saying at dinner, that NASA and other things have studied this phenomenon.
They can't figure out. They have no idea what these phenomena is.
Yeah.
But this wasn't like seeing them from a distance. That was weird. You know, it was like it was much closer. We were in dense woods. It wasn't like we were looking down over a valley top. Hmm. It was down in the trees. So the next day, we're still shooting the next day. I go down to take a look at the spot, and they had to have been, 75 feet off the ground.
Wow.
And they were in the middle of these very, very tall trees that were growing in off the mountain, kind of the cliffside. Hmm. And so I'm looking, and there is nothing down there. There's no way, and there is no line. So there had to have been,
something.
The phenomenon, whatever that was.
Wow, that's incredible. So, as you know, we have a couple of clips from two of your movies.
Cool.
The first one, Under the Bed. So if you could tell us a little bit about the movie, and then I'll have you set up the clip.
Sure. Under the Bed, you're right, came out in 2012, and it's a little horror picture about something under the bed, about a monster under the bed. And my two sons playing my kids in the movie. I'm trying to figure out how to say that. The kids in the movie. They believe there's a monster that's trying to get them, and that in the storyline, my oldest son had caused a fire trying to kill the monster, which killed my wife, his mother. So there's already tension between the son and I, and I think that I think they're nuts until the monster comes.
And then the clip that we have is
is kind of a mix of both what I'm confronting them about, what they're going through and what they're doing. And how they're acting, and then also when I discover that my sons are not full of shit.
Okay, if we could roll that clip. And we also have a caller who is on hold.
Neil, honey, I think what your dad is trying to say is that
Neil, are you listening?
Yes.
Yes? Okay, then what did we just say?
That I'm still crazy.
No, that is not what we just said.
That's all that anybody thinks. I'm not even getting a chance.
Okay, you don't get chances, kid. You earn them and you're not doing it.
Maybe I should have just died with Mom.
You took her to bed.
It's just me.
Dad!
Dad!
Stop!
Dad! Hell, it's going. Close the door!
What the hell's going on, you two? Were you guys just in here 5 minutes ago?
No, Dad! We have to get out of this house! We have to leave right now!
Was one of you walking around all wrapped up in a sheet or not, damn it! No, that's the thing! It's after us!
You guys are just little monsters! I've done nothing but try to be nice to you!
Angela! We're sorry, but you have to listen to us!
Yes, I do!
Get out of this house! We have to leave right now!
Yes, I do!
I love it.
Yeah.
Oh
yeah.
My gosh, that's intense.
That run, I love that run bit.
I absolutely love that.
Yeah.
Run! It was my attempt at everything Spielberg.
Yeah, there you go.
that was what we were going for with that. It was
a great film. The kids and I enjoyed it.
Thank you. I thought Stephen did a nice job. Stephen Miller, the director, did a nice job on that film.
Yeah, definitely. You always seem to have these wonderful kids that play your kids in these films, even though you probably weren't going to get Father of the Year award.
Yeah.
For, you know, being that father, but, you know.
Well, particularly in that one, I mean, it's you just kind of, I mean, trying to justify his behavior throughout it was difficult.
Right.
And trying to do it from some kind of loving way that it wasn't, you know, where he's just frustrated.
Right.
You know, he's a guy trying to keep his shit together and his kids are nuts.
Right. What do you do?
Yeah. I mean, it's not like we can't somewhat understand that feeling.
Right. No, I have no clue.
It reminds me of that story that I told you about with my dad. Mm. My dad was very routine. Every morning he would get up, you know, do the shower, put his bathrobe on, sit on the bed. And I was young and was very observant at that time. And I thought, wouldn't it be fun just to kind of sneak under the bed and scare him? So I was listening for him to finish the shower, and I'm giggling, you know, and I'm waiting. I know what side of the bed he's going to come sit on because he wants to get his socks on. He's getting ready for work. And he comes in, and I'm trying to hold it together. And this little kid, the feet go in front of me, and he sits on the bed, and I'm like waiting. And then all of a sudden I go, wah! And grab his feet. Scream like a little girl.
Did he run?
He was in shock, but, you know, under the bed.
Under the bed. Well, we have a caller that is patiently waiting for us, so if you want to go ahead. Hello, caller.
Hello.
Hi, you are on Paranormal Crossings. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. I'm Aaron. What is your name?
I'm Jillian Claire. I was in Alien Abduction with Peter.
Jillian awesome. Claire, yes.
Wonderful.
Hi, kid.
Hi.
Can you hear us okay?
Yeah, I can hear you great.
Okay, awesome. So tell us a little bit about your character in the film.
Well, it's funny. I think they really hired us to kind of play ourselves because of the style of film it is. It is sound footage. So a lot of it, you know, was us kind of just flying by the seat of our pants and truly acting like ourselves. So it's pretty much me in the film, except for the fact that I don't have brothers in real life. So I got to have fun with that and be the annoying sister.
Oh, that's
never
awesome.
Been before.
You did a great job on that.
Thank you. Thank you. I know. I really tuned into the annoyingness.
So I understand you're local. You're in Beaverton right now.
I am, yes. I'm actually at a business right now, so I snuck out for a couple minutes to come say hi.
Awesome. Well, I'm so glad that you called, and you'll be at the premiere tomorrow night?
Yes, Jillian.
Yes, I will.
Awesome. Yeah. Well, I look forward to meeting you then. And,
awesome.
Yeah, I'm very excited to see the film. I have purposely not seen it so I could see it for the first time in the theater.
I think that is a wise choice. This is definitely, I like it better in theaters because you get more of the crazy impact than you would if you're just watching it at home on your laptop in bed and like munching on ice cream.
The only thing is I won't be able to hide the fact that I'm actually scared. So I'll probably jump in my wife's lap or something, you know.
Oh, that's okay. My best friend is a guy, and he, the whole time in the theater in Los Angeles, he was jumping and screaming. It was hysterical.
That'll be me. I'll be crying. My hair. Oh, wait, I don't have hair.
although I will, just did what Jilly was saying, I'll say that if you don't see it tomorrow night, please feel free to watch it on iTunes, VOD,
yes.
Amazon Prime. What else, Jill? Anything else you can get it on?
I think that's it, yeah.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, I look forward to it, and our viewers, I'm sure they're all looking forward to seeing the film.
Yeah,
and so
hope
this
so.
Will be, yes, this will be nice. Well, thank you so much. Did you have anything else you wanted to say while you're still here?
Me?
Yes.
Just check out the film. You can follow it also on Twitter, which is AAFilm2014, and follow me,
awesome.
Jillian Claire. And yeah, I hope you guys enjoy it. It was really fun to make, and we had a blast out in North Carolina, and I think it's a great film, and hey, we're still top 5 in the iTunes charts for horror genre, I believe. So.
I know, we're
beautiful.
Holding, we're holding steady.
Oh,
hey, Joe,
gosh.
By the way, just to let you know, I checked out the bar next door to the theater. And
oh, my mom told me that you said that. I'm so excited. I'm going to try and bring my dog into
we're
the
stoked.
Bar.
Oh, it's Portland.
Dog,
you can bring,
so I bet I could get away with it.
You can bring dogs anywhere. You can bring a dog to Portland, absolutely. Just, you know, when you come in, tell them you're in the movie next door, we'll be fine.
Exactly. It's like, well, I was in the film that's playing next door. I can bring my dog in.
I'm
right?
from L.A. I have to bring my little dog in. No, go,
that's
it's
right.
okay. Yeah, exactly.
But she's not so little. She's a white German Shepherd.
Oh.
Oh, that's right. That's
oh
right.
My gosh.
You have a real dog.
Yeah, I have a dog.
Yeah.
Definitely not a lap dog. Although
no,
they like to be.
Although sometimes she likes to believe that she is.
Yes, right. Yes. Well, thank you so much. We really appreciate you calling in. And
awesome.
Again,
thank you so much. I'll see you guys tomorrow night.
Yes, yeah. We look so forward to it. Again, it's at the
Bye,
Clinton
Jill.
Street Theater, 10 o'clock p.m.,
10
May
p.m.
2nd, Friday night. And then, look forward to the film. Thank you so much. We'll see you tomorrow.
Awesome. Thank you.
All right. Have a good
Bye-bye.
Night.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye, Joe.
Awesome. What an awesome surprise.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's cool.
That's great.
She's
man.
A great kid. And she's got a new, I'll do a plug for her. She's got a web series called Acting Dead that's on JTV or JTS or something like that. It's one of the...
Acting Dead.
Acting All Dead. Right. It's a pretty fun, it's a funny little web series. They're doing kind of a horror zombie spoof.
Nice.
Web series that's a lot of fun.
Now you've done, I've seen you in various TV shows and movies. Mm-hmm. You've done anywhere from playing a cop to a soldier in World War II, a father many times over. Do you have a preference for a character or anything that you felt that this is my favorite character?
I mean, I've had favorites that I played. Mm-hmm. I mean, Gundy from Saints and Soldiers was a great character to play. I actually had a lot of fun working on this one. Alien Abduction was a lot of fun. Just the crew and the people who were working on it were really just lovely. But no, I don't have a... No. I mean, it's
just
not...
Whatever comes your way.
Whatever, the stuff that's interesting.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I think that I've kind of narrowed down my career to a point. I mean, if I was going to become a major, you know, Brad Pitt-esque star, that probably would have happened in my 20s.
Right. So you still got lots of life.
I'm still more going for the Phil Seymour Hoffman sort of idea.
Right.
That way is possible without the heroin. God rest his soul. Phil was a lovely guy.
That's tragic.
But, you know, I kind of narrowed down my entire business world and acting world to the same thing. And that's just doing cool shit.
Yeah.
You know, I just wanted to keep, as long as I'm kind of doing cool shit and we're working from that place, you know, I've made a living and raised a family and kept going. It's funny you were talking about the millionaire thing about actors, and interesting stat is only 3% of actors make a living.
Wow.
The top 1% make an amazing living, top 1.5%. But there's a lot of people in that, you know, 1-3% range that are just, you know, making a living, making a normal lower to, you know, middle class living.
Right. Mm.
And
the cost of living down there is just...
It doesn't matter. I mean, that's a nationwide stat. It doesn't matter if you're in Portland to here. I mean, there's people in town here who are, you know, making decent part-time money working the theater. You know, there's a really vibrant and lovely theater community here in Portland and doing some really, really interesting stuff.
Yeah.
And with that, there's some people who are, you know... Now, here it's not an entertainment town, so it's tougher to pay your mortgage with it. But you can still do a decent part-time job doing it up here.
Well, I told you my youngest son had asked, well, is he a millionaire?
Yeah.
I said, I don't know. I don't ask.
The answer's no. Me.
But you know, he did, before you showed up to the studio, he asked, one of the kids actually asked, is he going to be driving up in a Lamborghini? I said, I don't think so.
No.
Yeah.
That's funny. So. Even if I had a huge amount of money at this point, I would never own a Lamborghini.
Yeah, why?
I would have a Ford Fusion Energy.
No, there you go.
That's what I want.
Right.
108 miles to the gallon.
Yeah.
Things small enough, I can parallel park anywhere in Los Angeles.
See, it just shows you're getting older and wiser. And you're
well, yeah, and I don't give a shit about that kind of stuff. I never did.
Yeah.
I never cared about any of that kind of stuff. So
yeah. So tell us a little bit. Well, let me just tell the phone number. If you guys could put it back on the screen again to call in. The number is 503-667-7555. Look forward to hearing from you. Lovely Jillian.
Yeah.
Was Jillian kind Claire. Enough to call in, and that's great. Again, I'm really looking forward to the premiere tomorrow night, but the last time I saw you at a premiere was for Saints and Soldiers. Incredible film. You've got to see it if you haven't seen it.
And, it's on Netflix, I think, still.
It is. Oh, my gosh. I've watched it, I don't know how many times, on Netflix. I bought it and then watched it on Netflix. Saw
Appreciate
it at the premiere.
That.
I mean, come on. And so I absolutely love the character. Now, with your characters, with that particular character, you actually... In a roundabout way, portrayed your grandfather. Is that am I correct? Or
I did, and that one they allowed me to. We did some script changes to. He fought in the same battle. Mm-hmm. I mean, the end was different for my grandfather. Mm-hmm. You know, he survived.
Right.
I don't think I'm doing a big spoiler. My character doesn't. Mm. But yeah, allowed me to change the unit and change some of the aspects of that. And part of that wasn't just to, you know, for the fact of making it my grandfather, which was cool, and it was a really nice thing for my family and all that. But I also had access to research from him. from his regimental records, the stuff that came back and my grandmother had that a lot of, you know, when the family really looked through. So I was able to use that to really research what those guys were going through as much as possible.
Well, the thing I loved about that film is the how real the characters were, how real your character was, and the other guys. And it seemed like, at least on screen, you really connected with each other. And that's the other thing I liked about the film. And it wasn't just about a bunch of guns and shooting and, you know, and all this. I mean, it was really about each particular character and what they're going through and what they've gone through.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, fantastic film. So.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm proud of that one.
Yeah. So, okay, so getting back to Under the Bed. A wonderful film. It was nice to be able to go to Redbox and pick it up and you know.
Yeah.
How does that feel? I mean, to know that you've got films on online that you can that people can pay for and download and go to Redbox and, you know, and watch on Netflix. I mean, are you beyond that whole, oh my gosh, that's exciting? Are you just at the point where, oh, this is cool?
Yeah, I mean, I think up to the point where it's cool. I mean, it's exciting. Anytime you have anything done that gets out there, it's exciting. I mean, so much better than so many of the films that I've been in that haven't, you know, that haven't gone anywhere.
Right.
You know, look at the IMDb, plenty of credits there that you do not recognize.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think I'm jaded, but I have gotten to the point where I kind of recognize what it all is, you know.
Right.
And it really, it's in some ways, it's going back down to just the whole idea of theater, you know, people dig stuff and they don't.
Yeah.
And I'm okay enough with you not digging it.
Right.
And hoping most of it you do.
Right.
So,
well, you know, it's the whole alien abduction thing. I mean, there's so it seems like over the last 10 years, the whole paranormal field has just boomed. And, you know, as you know, I'm a paranormal investigator. I mean, I've had this fascination and curiosity since I was 10, since I had my first paranormal experience. Elise is a psychic medium, and so we have our own NW paranormal investigative team. And but the whole alien thing, it's always been a curiosity of mine. I mean, I think a lot of us in the back of our minds, are there really aliens?
Statistically speaking, there has to be. I mean, it just
we would be naive
sense
to think that we're the only ones here. I mean, come on.
Right.
And so with the alien abduction film, was this actually based on footage that was actually found, or is that just part of the story?
That's part of the story.
Just part of the story.
Yeah, that's the conceit of the story to get us there.
Okay.
And in the premise of the story, the kid playing my youngest son is an autistic child.
Okay.
And he uses camera as a piece of therapy, which is a therapy for some autistic conditions.
Wow.
For high functioning. And it's basically just a way that they can look at the camera in ways to separate from the world they're in.
That's true. I have a girlfriend in New York, and her daughter is extremely savant.
Really?
And I came up to see what she was doing to check on her, and she had the video camera going on a Disney movie. And she was the director, and she was doing it and singing, and then she would take her Barbie dolls and put them in front. And, you know, so yeah, it was amazing, though.
That's pretty cool.
Well, and the use of therapy. So in the conceit of this film is that he films everything that's going on in his life, which works out really well when you're trying to do a found footage film.
Right.
Because you have a reason why the camera is there. I mean, you know, and it doesn't have to be like Blair Witch where they're having to slobber and, you know, show snot
and the TV cameras going.
They're still jumping. I mean, there's Luke Gussard, who did our DP, was great. Did Borat. He did all the Sacha Baron Cohen's movies. It's a lovely DP. He really does a good job, I think, in this of making the camera the character. You know, because so much of Riley, the youngest son's character, is behind the camera. You know, you hear him say occasional lines, and you see him occasionally, but he's felt. And by really, Luke did a great job of taking the camera and making it that character, so you're feeling like you're seeing it from his perspective. I mean, you know, there's some spots where it was a little more difficult to do than others and still get the drama in the film.
Do you think you were more of a believer after the film was done than you were going into the film?
Absolutely.
Things you would have
been. Yeah, I mean, while I'm skeptical, I'm not negative, because, I mean, who am I to...
Well, yeah. Do any of us really know?
There's so many things that that are possible, you know. But yeah, absolutely. I mean, seeing those lights, I saw them.
Yeah. Mm.
They were right there.
That's awesome.
And you know, were they able to get that on the camera as well?
Yeah. When you see the film, when you see there's footage in it, that's actual news footage of the lights. It's not.
So that is
not
real
stuff
footage.
We shot. Okay. Yeah, that's the news footage you see there of the lights, all that's real.
Okay.
And I think we actually got some footage we shot of the actual lights, too, that are intermixed. that aren't created lights.
Okay.
I think actually there's only one scene in the film where they actually recreated the lights.
Okay.
As far as what you see in the sky.
Right. Mm. That's pretty cool. So you're going to be watching this, and I mean, if this is, there's some truth to this.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, it's all out of. I mean, the abduction stories are based out of the legend. Although there are people up there who have believe they've been abducted, and very, very sincerely do. I mean, I think the most recent case was 88 or 89 of a guy who was abducted and came back. And was, you know, has obviously been derailed for being crazy and all this stuff. And
Where was it located?
North Carolina. It's in the Western Mountains of North Carolina, right around Brown Mountain.
I think the most famous was the one they based the movie Fire in the Sky.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure where that took place.
Oh, that wasn't in North Carolina.
I think that was New Mexico.
Was it New Mexico?
New Mexico, I think.
I know that they were loggers.
No, right. It was, where's Frank?
Yeah, Frank's out there.
Frank
somewhere.
Fitzgerald, if you're out there, you know the answer to this one.
Call
it in.
503-667-7555.
Get your cell phone out and call it in.
That's right. So we have a clip from Alien Abduction.
Awesome.
So if you could set us up a little bit.
We're on a camping trip, family camping trip in the Blue Mountains, where Brown Mountain is. And we are... Our GPS has sent us on the wrong way. And we've been following the GPS trying to get it. It's led us into this place.
All right. Okay, yeah. If we could roll that clip.
Or
do you guys have that clip ready? There we go.
Whoa, what in the hell is this?
What the heck?
Oh my God. Is that an accident?
It doesn't look like one. Is anybody in there?
No. No, no one's there. Where are they?
I don't know.
Jeez. What the hell?
What the hell's going on here?
Whoa.
Peter.
Whoa.
This is really weird.
Here, look at all this stuff.
This is just...
There aren't any people.
Okay. The people who own these cars have to be somewhere.
Dad, this is really creeping me out.
Yeah. No, I'm with you.
Maybe we should turn around now.
We don't have any choice. We have no gas. We can't get back to the highway. We have to go this way. All right. So, you guys all sit tight, okay? I'm gonna go find these folks.
Are you serious?
Careful.
Yes, I'm serious, Corey.
I'm coming with you, Dad.
I'm coming too.
Guys, I'd really rather you not. I'd rather you stay in the car. Okay, that's good.
Mom, I gotta pee.
Hold on, honey. I gotta come with you. Riley, are you gonna go with your dad? Peter?
Yeah.
Just keep an eye on him.
Wait for me, Dad.
I'm all right. You gotta stay close, buddy, okay?
All of the seatbelts are torn out of the car. This is weird.
Awesome.
Wow.
That was a creepy
Don't
day,
get out of the car!
Yeah.
That's the rule!
Isn't that the first thing you said is don't get out of the car and everybody's out of the car?
And you're like, okay, great.
Yeah, Dad said not to get out, let's go ahead and get
and
out.
Just like
it's my, just aliens.
And just like my family, they didn't listen. They followed us in. Yeah, that tunnel is actually really interesting where we shot that. It's about a quarter mile long.
Really?
And it was built in, it's a road that ends that doesn't go to anywhere, and it was built in the 30s, I think. I think it was a WPA tunnel they built, mm-hmm. because they were trying to connect. That right next to there Civil War cemetery that's right on the other side of it. That they had been promising since the Civil War to give access to, because literally the only way you could do it was hiking in down into this cemetery.
Wow! Right.
So they built this tunnel with the idea they were going to build a road that was going to continue on, and then. You know, through a boondoggle of this or that, people, you know, getting paid off, it didn't happen. So there's just literally this unbelievable long tunnel in the middle of nowhere. It is so long that when you stand in the middle and the way the acoustics are, you can hear exactly what's going on the other sides of the tunnel.
Oh my gosh.
In detail, and yet when you're on the outside of the tunnel, it's like a sound block.
Can't hear anything.
Do you hear sounds that are not associated with people that are with you in the tunnel?
Maybe, because you hear the echo, but it's only in the middle. Once you get outside of that, it's like you're in this kind of, you sound like you're in a muffled place until you hit that zone where the acoustics all bring it back. In fact, we shot the, just a few seconds later, a bit where I see the alien for the first time, in that section specifically, so we could try and get the reverberation off the walls in the when there's a big scream I do when I, you know, right. I see the thing. But that tunnel was freaky. And it was literally like 80 degrees outside, and then you go inside and it would drop 20, 30 degrees inside the tunnel.
I mean, almost it's like a cave.
Well, yeah. Well, it is a cave. I mean, it's underneath this mountain of granite.
Okay.
That's crazy.
It's pure granite. So you're underneath there and it's freaking cold. The minute you walked into it, you walk outside of it, you're just sweating your balls off.
You live in Vancouver. Have you heard of Ape Caves?
Yeah, I've been there.
Have you been there?
Is it the, what's the one, the there's caves. One in Oregon too. The lava, oh gosh, it's in Southern, or.
But the ape caves, we went during summertime.
Is there apes there?
Other than myself, no, I didn't see any apes, but you know, but it was like 85, 90 degrees, and we go down into the cave.
Yeah, you want to be
like
in the cave.
Literally 40 degrees.
Unless you're scared of vampires.
Intense.
Yeah.
I mean,
well, there's a lot of bats in there, and so, you know.
Yeah,
could have been.
So I know that we have a caller. So going back to Fire in the Sky,
yes.
We weren't sure where that was filming. I think that's actually Frank that's called in. So we can go ahead and take that. Hello, caller. This is Aaron Collins. You are on Paranormal Crossings. Who is this?
Hi.
Hi, is this Frank?
Yes, how you doing?
Good, Frank. How you doing, man?
Very good. How are you?
I'm excellent. So do you know the answer to the question that Pete threw out at you?
Oh, boy.
Where was Fire in the Sky?
What state? Actual, what state was Fire in the Sky take place in?
The real one, yeah.
Yeah.
The original story.
I'm having a real hard time hearing you guys.
You want to phone a friend?
Echo.
Oh, you hear an echo? You probably have to step outside the studio to talk to us.
Los Angeles.
Los Angeles.
Fire in the Sky. No, I don't. I don't know which one it is.
Oh. Okay.
Oh.
All right. Well, do you have a question, comment, concern?
Well, I love the show.
Oh, awesome.
Thank you, Matt.
Well, we appreciate that. What a fan. What an awesome guy. You know, so
I thought you'd be the guy to know, though, Frank. I thought you'd be the guy to be able to help us on that one.
Can you hear us, Frank?
I can barely
hear you.
You can barely hear us?
It's because we're whispering.
We're the host whisperers.
It must be my phone. You know, I think it's just my phone.
The host whisperers. That's right.
Bad connection. Bad
All
connection.
Right, Frank. Well, thanks for calling. We appreciate it.
Hey, I will talk to you guys again.
All right.
Absolutely.
Talk to you soon. Thanks, man.
Bye-bye.
All right, bye. So Frank, truth be told, is a friend of ours. We all went to high school together. And
yeah.
So. Frank's a good guy.
Well, I tell you, this list goes on and on and
you
on
know,
and
I'm
on
telling
and on.
You.
There were a lot of
it's
students
like a family,
there.
It's like a whole high school reunion.
We
that's
own
been happening.
Gresham. Come on. Mm-hmm. We just took this place over.
If any of us still lived here.
Me. I moved away and came back. Here
are you,
I
living,
am,
are you so. Living back in Gresham?
I am.
Oh, I didn't know
I
that.
I am. I've been back here probably, well, since 2007.
Oh, okay.
So I moved pretty far, like way far away to a place called Vancouver, Washington.
Right.
Yeah, so I lived out there.
Did you need a passport to come back in? And
I did.
Yeah.
And had to cross the toll bridge and, you know, go through customs and the whole bit.
What does that say? Not Washington, D.C. and Portland. It's Portland, Maine.
Maine.
Yeah. People get that so good. Because when you say Vancouver, they go, oh my gosh, you live in Canada?
Yeah, no.
It's like...
No, Vancouver, no. Washington.
Washington, right, Washington, D.C.? No.
No.
U.S. history, people. Didn't we... Anybody pay attention?
Well, you know...
Apparently. Or just geography.
Geography,
yeah.
I mean...
Yeah, geography.
Didn't they have that puzzle you put together that taught
how
you the states?
How fast you could... Yeah, or how fast you could list the states. Yeah, I didn't...
My wife's big on the capital. She knows every capital of every state, and she's known them since she was in middle school whenever she memorized them. So she'd be like, drill my kids when they were young.
What's she's the just state flower?
Thought it was terribly important. No, it was just capitals. Yeah. She didn't get into that. But boy, my kids, they can rattle off any capital. Like North Dakota. What's North Dakota?
I don't know.
Me neither. I don't remember.
I don't know.
Yeah, but you know Oregon's state capital.
Yeah.
It is.
Oregon City. No, Salem. It used to be Oregon City.
It used to be Oregon City. Yeah.
It did.
Did it really?
It did. Yeah. You're laughing. It was.
Well, originally. I grew up in Beaverton.
And it's for Beaverton.
Oregon.
My condolences. I mean, no, it's great.
She's a West Sider.
That's yeah. Right.
Well, I'm from Tennessee. So.
I wouldn't go over there anymore, though. I mean, you can't even get through.
Memphis, Tennessee. You went back to Memphis with me once.
I did. That was
went
fun.
Did we go into Elvis's house, or did we just go to the museum?
They were closed.
They were closed?
Elvis's house was closed for remodeling when we went by.
Mm. We should have just hopped the fence. Knowing you and I back then, we
totally
just,
could
you know,
have.
Gotten shot. That'd be a story to tell.
Yes, but I think your parents were afraid of us getting arrested.
Probably.
That got said a couple of times before leaving. Now, boys, don't get arrested in Tennessee.
Just please be good.
Jesus, please.
You're going with Pete. You've got to be good.
Just try.
So as my memory is not as good as it as the older I get,
what'd you
tell
say?
Me again. What? Yeah. Tell me again where I can go see this movie at tomorrow.
That is the Clinton Street Theater. In Portland at 10 p.m. tomorrow night.
And you're going to be there.
I'm going to be there. Jillian's going to be there.
Right.
We'll do a little Q&A after.
There's a little bar right
There's
next door.
There's a bar right next door.
Perfect.
Which works out well. Because I've always felt acting and drinking should go together as much
as
possible.
You got me at bar. So,
right.
Yeah. So, Frank, we'll be there.
And that's
you
get most of our graduating class, too. Come on down.
The whole 88, 89 graduating class from Gresham.
Come on down.
Right.
We'll have a few.
Enjoy.
You know what? That'd be a great reunion. Well, I guess since you're here, it is a reunion.
Yeah, we're kind of doing that.
Graduating class is going to be there anyway. So.
That's right. Those of us that actually graduated, absolutely.
Yeah, graduated, still alive, you know.
Exactly.
I'll be there. It's Peter.
I know. We were taking, at Christmas, we were taking this family photo, and my cousin who went to Barlow, we're just all getting our generation's picture taken. And he puts his shoulder on mine and my brother's head and he goes, "We're in the next generation of old people." I'm like, damn, man, you're right.
Don't ruin it for
you're
me.
You're right.
You know, I've gotten to the point where my kids will come and they'll say, "Well, let me get that for you, Dad." Or let me do it, you know, and I'm like,
"Stop it, I can do it."
I'm not.
That's how, I can tell you that, that's how I got triple hernia surgery.
Oh,
was
you know what?
On under the bed.
Okay, so you got to tell the story. Now, we only have about 8 minutes.
Okay, but I'll try and keep it under eight.
Six.
Okay.
So tell us the story about
So we're doing
the big dad and wanting to.
We're doing the scene in there's a scene in it where I become demon dad, where it's a kind of a dream sequence thing.
Whoa.
And we got to think it's 5 minutes. She just wanted
five
to be clear
minutes,
on
all
that.
Right. Thank you.
And I, you know, they want to ask if I want a stuntman for these fight sequences. I'm like, "No, I don't need a stuntman. I'm cool. No big deal. Doing this shit for a long time, you know."
Yeah.
And then the older one, who's 23, says to me, "Hey, you know, do you want me to take it easy on you, guy?"
Old man.
You know, basically. I'm like, "You're not taking it easy on me, pal. You come at me, I'll be throwing your ass around all over." Yeah, absolutely. I was just, I was incensed.
Five of you, come on.
Incensed.
All of a sudden, it's WWE, right?
Totally. So we start doing it. I'm throwing these kids one-armed. I'm doing all the stuff. There's one I've got. It was a perfect throw, too. I've got... It's Johnny Weston, who's also in Maverick, the movie Maverick.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, Johnny plays my son. Anyway, so I've got him by the scruff, and I start to throw him, and as I throw him, I feel this huge pull.
Oh.
Okay. But then I don't want to act like he's wrong, so I'm like, it's cool.
Right.
I keep doing it the rest of the day.
Your face is beat red.
Well, they couldn't tell because I was in this Damon makeup.
Oh,
right? I have all the makeup on,
oh, that's
so they couldn't
right.
actually see a lot of the pain that's in my face.
And of course, you didn't pass out right that moment, so all was good.
No, I almost passed out. So then later I go out, and I feel like this, I sit down and there's like fire in my groin, just this incredible burning, tearing sense feeling. So I go to the doctor, I'm thinking, okay, well, I've got a hernia of some kind. He's like, "No, you have three."
Oh,
I had ripped
gosh.
The entire groin.
Do it right. Yeah.
I did. I ripped the whole thing and they had to the guy's like, "I have to mesh everything."
Wow.
And I'm like, "Well, I'm in the middle of a film."
Yeah.
I'm like, "What do you do?"
He hands me. Can you put some staples in there? Can you?
Yeah, I'm like, "Yeah, could you just give me one stitch? Just one thing, tie it off, something? I got 4 days left of this shit." So he gives me basically a bottle of pills and said, "Have fun.
Enjoy it."
He goes, "You cannot possibly rip it more than you already have, so just go finish it."
And of course, the viewers don't know this, but I gave you a piggyback ride on the way in here. So
that's right.
You're still having some issues.
I'm still having issues. No, I'm fine now. Yeah. I'm fine
good,
now.
Good, good, good. So when was that film made, or when did you actually do the filming for Under the Bed? Was it in 2011 that you filmed, or was it actually?
Actually, I think we shot in 2012 and came out in 2013.
Okay.
So any future movies coming up?
Oh, you've got a lot of projects coming
up. Couple coming up. As an actor, I've got a movie called Perception we're shooting right now with Sharon Lawrence and Chris Collar. I've got another one called Some Kind of Hate that I'm doing. I'm shooting in a couple of weeks. And then as a director, I've got a movie called Grief Camp, comedy that we're doing.
So we have a lot yeah. coming from you.
There's yes. a lot of stuff. Things are, blessedly, I'm working.
Well, I tell you, it has been an absolute honor and pleasure to have you on.
Thank you, man. It's been a blast.
I'm just so excited that you're in town. And I haven't seen you in 11 years. So
I know, it's been a long
time. It's always nice to catch up and have a few beers together. So
indeed.
So tomorrow night.
It's so great meeting you.
Yes, you too. Yeah. Absolutely. We had so much fun the other night.
Yes. Well, we'll do it again tomorrow night.
Yeah, tomorrow night. Come on down tomorrow night.
Everybody, come party with us. We're going to have some beer after the movie. And
we'll get really drunk and go look for ghosts.
We'll do ghost hunting.
Yes.
Good idea.
Oh, I bet that theater, it might be haunted.
Yeah.
I bet it is. It's an old theater.
It's like one of the first theaters in, like, Rickon America. I mean, it's, like, been there forever.
I think Steve brought it up, actually. I don't know where he's at. He's back there somewhere.
But we'll have a little investigation off on the side.
Yeah.
Man,
you know what? Do a little investigating and drinking.
One hell of a night. Yeah. There you go. So, again, it's at Clinton Street Theater at 10 p.m. It's Friday, May 2nd, tomorrow night. All right, Peter, thank you so much.
Oh, thanks for having me,
guys. We appreciate it. And, yes, for those of you that are curious, follow Peter on Facebook. He's also on Facebook. You're also on...
We're getting the vamp sign.
Yes. Please continue. you are also on imdb.com.
You can
and
find
so
my you, stuff.
They can find all your filmography and see everything that you've done. And
and they can go to... coming up to also Three Heads Productions is a new company I created that we're creating TV pilots.
Mm, awesome.
And our first show on the line will be coming out soon, hopefully.
Wonderful.
I'm not in that. I directed that, but it's a really fun workplace comedy.
Now, are you still doing the Rat Bastards production?
Rat Bastard, I folded.
Oh, did you? Okay.
I mean, we still have Down for Life. One of our films will come up under that, but no, we folded
that. Is that the gang? That.
The gang picture,
okay,
yeah. That's finally coming out, hopefully,
Sweet.
This year. Yeah, we're hopefully working with E1 to
good.
Do it. So.
Well, good. Well, I'm excited. You're doing very well.
Yeah, cool.
And you're busy, so we'll have to check it all out. So, all right, well, it looks like we have still a little bit more time. And
we're still going.
And now we're still going. So again, you can catch us every Thursday night at 7 p.m. here at Community Access Metro East.
Yes,
and
we're
channel
you to
22.
Them.
Yeah,
thank
Comcast
you so
22.
Much.
And thank you so much, Metro East. You've all been wonderful and it's
generous.
Exciting. And all of our producers, Love Niswessa, we appreciate. Steve Schroba, we've got Frank Martin. And we just appreciate everything you guys are doing and some goofs that are jumping up and down in the back. So anyways, we appreciate it. And again, you could always call during the show, 503-667-7555. We'd always love to take your calls and talk to you. If you have any comments, feel free to give the station a call and say, hey, I love that show. Make them do something else. Or, you know, here, give us a topic, a different topic. We've got a lot of exciting guests coming on via Skype. So that's going to be really interesting. So we are doing very well. So thank you again. We appreciate it. Have a good night. Have a good week.
Good night.
All right. Goodbye.
Yay. I'm being your studio audience.
Oh, yay. Yeah. Applause button. We need the applause button.
Yay. Yeah, you guys start applausing for yourselves.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's a good one.
He does that on the blog
and we're recording.
Did you plot the blog?
Oh, I'm
good.
So sorry.
Are we still on?
Yeah, I don't know. People are watching me right now.
Hey, here we are. All right. Blog talk did not work at all. Could not get it to work at all.
Well, I'm going to say that if you, depending on the internet connection in here, forget it.
It wasn't the internet. And it definitely wasn't the internet.
We're not on still, are we?
It was the audio. So.
At 58:30, you cut off.
We are done.
So. No, all right. I took my medication and it
makes
me.
I'm like,
so
I
was like, next time. No, I mean, it was like,
just
I
so you know,
like,
I was swapping cameras more until she went back.